Although Mr. Agnew has disappeared from the scene, some of the questions he raised have not. Those questions having to do with the ideological tendencies of network television and radio and other related questions have to do with the general impact of television on U.S. culture, and they are almost obsessively before the House. In 1977, for the first time, TV viewing actually decreased, and the postmortems are endless, the most pessimistic of them being to the effect that TV is us. And to confess any disappointment in TV is to deplore our own culture. And that is the end of that argument. The arguments do not end ever for Mrs. Dorothy Fuldheim, among the most celebrated and certainly the most venerable television and radio journalists and commentators in the United States. Her home is here in Cleveland from WEWS for almost as many years as we have had television. She has centered her activity as an interviewer whose opinions and commentary are observed everywhere, bringing her award after award. She is the author of several books, including I Laughed, I Loved, I Cried, and in the industry, she is known as the first anchorwoman in the United States. Ben Stein is a graduate of Columbia and of the Yale Law School, and the author of a much discussed book, The View from Sunset Boulevard. Mr. Stein wrote television criticism for the Wall Street Journal, speeches for President Nixon, articles for Esquire, Playboy, and the New York Times, and three books. And then he decided to go to Hollywood, responding to an invitation from Norman Lear, who couldn't find anybody in Los Angeles who could utter a witticism in behalf of a right-wing character in a contemplated series, All's Fair. Mr. Stein's extraordinary book, in which he gives us a portrait of the ideologically homogenized television producing industry in Los Angeles, asks questions Mrs. Fuldheim unquestionably has a position on. Our examiner today is the distinguished publisher and editor of the Cleveland Plain Dealer, Mr. Thomas Vail, whom I shall introduce in due course. I should like to begin by asking Mrs. Fuldheim whether, in her opinion, she discerns this orthodoxy about which Mr. Stein and others have written.
Well, first you'll have to explain to me what you mean by his orthodoxy.
An orthodoxy. Well, why don't you describe the orthodoxy?
Yes, why don't you?
Well, what I notice on television is that there are certain characteristics that certain stereotypical people have on television. For instance, all businessmen, if it's an adventure show, are evil, murderous, hypocritical, cheating scoundrels. If it's a situation on television.
And I just want to know whether they are or they're not. Well, is it a true delineation of them?
Oh, yeah. I mean, the book is not supposed to be fiction.
No, I don't mean is that the way they are.
She wants to know if you know a businessman who is not a murderer.
Thank you very much.
Oh, sure. No,
stand by, I'll need you again.
No, that it seems to me is not a true delineation of them. And similarly, on television, all small towns are evil, vicious places where the big city innocent goes, his car breaks down, he gets caught in a web of murder and kidnapping and extortion. And all military men are, if it's an adventure show, are planning for a neo-Nazi takeover, and if it's a sitcom, they're buffoons. On crime shows, the criminal is almost always a middle class, so well-to-do person of the majority group. There are almost no poor people portrayed as committing crimes. The criminals, even if a poor person has committed a crime, he's been forced into doing it by a businessman or some other middle class seeming person. There are no useful or vital religious figures on television. They're all either buffoons or kind of helpless fuddy-duddies. There is this kind of overwhelming stereotyping of certain power centers and power groups in the society as either bad or foolish. And then there are certain groups which are very good. For instance, policemen on the beat are always very good.
How about newspaper publishers?
Well, they used to be bad, but now they're good. Now there's one show which
post Watergate, they're good.
That's right. That's right.
You know, Mr. Stein, while you're talking, I'm wondering what category I come.
Well, you're not a sitcom.
Well, I know, but it touches me. I think that's a lot of baloney. I really do. I mean, you mean to tell me that millions of people are such idiots that they're going to watch pictures or stories, or whatever it is, that portray people, stereotypes constantly?
Well,
I'm not.
This is absolutely happening without any question at all. And you may call it baloney, but I watch television, and the people who let me just say that even the people who make television, even the Gary Marshalls and Norman Lears of Hollywood, do not really dispute that this stereotyping
goes on.
Well,
then they are shameful. If that is true, then let them reform. They're the ones that are putting out these.
I wasn't blaming you, Miss Fuldheim.
I'm blaming the producers, because if what you say is true, it's lamentable, and it could be very pernicious and very dangerous. And I think that men who are in that position of responsibility owe something to the people who are watching television. I think if what you're saying is true, it really is a very serious and reprehensible condition.
Well, it is a very serious condition. That's why I wrote the
book. You stop smiling.
Do I understand that since you have issued instructions to Hollywood to reform, the problem is over?
No, of course not, because they won't reform.
Oh, well, what are we going to do about it?
That's exactly the point. I don't know that you can do anything. Mr. Stein is in a position to. Of course they won't. They won't listen to me. If they did, everything would be solved. You wouldn't have any problems at all. I could take care of inflation. Today, you took care of oil. I mean, you know, we could do it.
That X problem.
Yes.
Well,
I wish you wouldn't be so placid about it.
I don't think I agree. I don't think we should be placid about it. But let's ask, how come you didn't observe this, since you are famous as a very observant woman?
What do you mean? Well, I didn't observe
this bias.
I don't think all of the pictures that he's talking about, the television shows, are that bad. Not at all. There's a soap opera that my granddaughter watches, and I notice that when I'm at home, I stop to look at it. You know, this is true of life. These things happen. And if, I know there are a couple of virtuous businessmen. Tom Vail was a virtuous one. Oh, I think. I don't know enough about him to tell you.
I don't. My point is that there are virtuous businessmen. And also, my book had nothing to do with soap operas or whether the shows are good or bad or fun to watch or boring to watch. The point is just that there is an enormous amount of kind of background noise on these TV shows, which is a fully alternate reality, or maybe I should say alternative reality, of American life. People watch TV so much that it's like a second life for them. And in this second life, conditions are very different from what they are in real life. That is, in real life, one occasionally finds a businessman who is not plotting to murder his go-go dancer girlfriend. On TV, if a standard episode of Starsky and Hutch...
They just don't pass the screen test.
Right. on TV, a standard episode of Barnaby Jones or Starsky and Hutch will be that a go-go dancer has been murdered. And there are three suspects. And one is her boyfriend, who has just gotten out of jail after serving 20 years for murder. And the other one will be the janitor who cleans up the club, and he is a heroin addict. And the other one will be the head of the local utility company who stops in there for a drink on his way to the train. Now, invariably, the killer will be the head of the local utility company. And this is a reality which it seems to on TV, which it seems to me tends to screw up most people's perceptions of real life. I often think that a lot of people's anger at the oil companies is based upon the fact that all they've seen on TV are villainous, scheming, heartless businessmen. So they begin to think that all businessmen in real life are like that.
I mean, I don't know what kind of movies he's been watching or on television.
Well, he just mentioned
I know what he said. I don't know much about go-go girls. Maybe they should be murdered. I don't know. Are the go-go girls the ones that... what are the go-go girls?
I think on TV they dance topless. But, I mean, they don't show them dancing topless.
I think that a topless bathing suit or anything else is really killing the graces and romance of sex, but that's beside the point.
No, not entirely.
Well, I mean, no. But, the fact is that styles change. I really think that sex without romance is a kind of a dull bore, would you say?
I understand your point.
That's all I asked for. Yeah. I watch MASH, I watch Barney Miller.
Well, MASH is a perfect example of what the book is about, because one of the parts of the book is that on television, military men are in two different categories. If they are enlisted men or draftees, they are saintly, virtuous people. If they are professional military officers, they are killers. Their whole aim in life is to kill
and
torment.
That's not so of MASH.
Oh, it is absolutely true of MASH.
In
MASH, the people who are the heroes.
The officer in charge is a very nice guy.
But he is a
draftee. He writes his wife every week.
But he is a draftee. All the people in the mobile surgical hospital are draftees. The people who come over from headquarters are only concerned with bombing civilians. MASH is the absolutely pluperfect example of how on television a professional army man is one inch away from being an SS man.
You know, I want to say something. Maybe he is right. I'm not going to argue that. But I think the television is one of the greatest influences that has ever occurred in civilized society, for it is going to create a homogeneous quality between people. The alienation, the different customs which separate us by, really not important, but because they were different. And I think that the average person who would not read the National Geographic or the Saturday Review or any of these magazines can see things in television. It may be true that there are these shows too, but generally the whole standard of knowledge has been raised, not only in this country but all over. For example, you can see a ballet, you can hear opera. How many people could afford to go to the opera? Now, it's true not all people listen to that, but it trickles down. There is an addition to the culture and erudition as a result of television.
Well, that is true of public television, but that is certainly not true of primetime commercial television.
You're talking about my television station, and I don't agree with
you. Well, as a matter of fact, Mr. Stein, I don't think you have any quarrel with the technological reach of television. I remember, and this was not on public television, I remember when Leonard Bernstein lifted his baton on the Ford, I think it was called the Ford Theater, it was back around 1953, to lead the symphony and chorus in Bach's B minor Mass. And he said to his audience, more people will hear Bach's B minor Mass, will have heard it 1.5 hours from now, than have heard it since it was composed in 1730.
Correct.
Now that is remarkable.
That is a great achievement, but that is an extremely rare achievement. That was an awfully
not
long time
Saturday
ago.
Not every Saturday night. Every Saturday, there is opera.
Well, not on the three networks, I assure you. I think to whatever extent public television or these infrequent high culture events on commercial television occur, there is an enormous backlash going in the other direction, which is that television tends to lower the standard of national culture by taking time that people might otherwise spend reading or doing almost anything, and instead subjecting them to this kind of alternate reality, which is a reality in which nothing is difficult, there is no thought, there is no analysis, everything is done by squealing automobile tires and by people making fun of one another. That is the reality in which people lose themselves for 4 and 5 hours a day on television is not a very enlightening or uplifting reality. It's a reality which says that life is best lived effortlessly, driving to the beach, shooting people, making fun of the people who live below you in the apartment below you. It does not really add much, it seems to me, to the human spirit.
Interesting. Let me ask Ms. Fuldheim this. If you consider the librettos of the standard repertoire of operas, most of which, of course, were composed in the 19th century.
Full of murder, killing.
Full of murder and killing, and the aristocracy, they were always the villain, were they not? It was always the count of somebody. And interestingly enough, Lieutenant Pinkerton was a professional Navy man.
A very good point, which people often raise, the answer to which is, how many people watched Madame Butterfly 5 hours a day, every day of their life? That is, in the past, when there were cultural events, people could differentiate them from life and say, well, this is an amusement. At present, people swim in a sea of television almost as much as they do anything else. so that television's messages take on an importance and a significance and a weight which cannot really be matched by any other form of entertainment.
Mr. Stone, may I ask you, how many cultivated people listen to Madame Butterfly 5 hours a day? Discount be done, it isn't. And when you talk about books, the fact is...
Puccini wouldn't have listened to it,
no, of course not.
Well, exactly
and
my point.
And of course, there are more books read and sold since television than there were before.
Well, because the population of the country has increased by about 80 million in that time.
I don't think that would account for it.
You mean per capita?
Yes.
Well, I don't have the figures, but I'm presumptively skeptical because there aren't that many hours a day. The average man works 1 hour and a half, spends one and a half hours more watching television than he does working. It's something like 36 to 35. And I don't see how he can devote that many hours to television and still read as many books as he would otherwise have read, do you?
You know, I have made a valiant effort to save television for you. If you took television off for one day, you would have a storm of protest. You could stop printing the newspaper.
They couldn't get gas to go to the rallies.
that, of course, is a handicap. I don't quite understand the abuse of something which has brought... Could I tell you a story?
Sure.
To illustrates what I mean. One day I was waiting for my car, and our station is where there's a bus stop. And a bus stopped there, and a woman got out. I knew that she was a woman in humble circumstances because I could tell by the clothes she was wearing, you know, the skirt had been washed a half a dozen times. She was carrying a package in her hand, and she stopped and looked at me, and she said, "Oh, is it really you, you know?" And it embarrasses me a little when people treat me as something odd that kind. So to make conversation, I said to her, "Oh, you've been visiting, haven't you?" She had this little package in her hand. I could tell she was arthritic by the way she was holding it. She said, "Yes, every Thursday I go to see my daughter. She gives me my dinner because that's the night that he is working, presumably her son-in-law." I said, "Where do you live?" Now, about four blocks down from our station, there's a high rise, you know, where we put old people to get them away, like you graze a nice a horse that has served you well, and you put them off to pasture. Well, she lived there, and I said, "Do you work?" She said, "No, not anymore." I think she'd been a charwoman. I could tell it by her whole manner. And I said, "Well, what do you live on?" She said, "My Social Security." I asked her how much it was. At that time, it was $183. I said, "What do you pay for rent?" $36. I said, "Well, how do you manage?" And this is the whole point of the story. She said, "Oh, I'm all right." She said, "You know, I have two friends. One is God, and the other's my television set." Now, what would happen to these great groups of
you know,
known
people? Your point is a very bizarre one, because I don't think that anyone that I know of at least has suggested taking away television. Don't you agree that for the sake of this poor woman, as well as all the other people in this country, the television should be as good as possible?
You don't think there's enough talent for that in the world?
I think there's enough talent to make it an awful lot better than it is.
Yeah, I don't think, Ms. Fuldheim, at least having read the book, I didn't see anything in Mr. Stein's thesis that that argued against
I didn't read the book,
entertainment.
I can only judge by what he's saying.
Yeah, but take our word for it. How's that? but he is saying that there are stereotypes. Now, for instance, if those stereotypes were to the disadvantage of Jewish people, or to the disadvantage of blacks or whatever, there'd be screams and yells of protest because we are against Little Black Sambo, we're against the Step and Fetch It type business, we're against the Merchant of Venice. And this, I think, is a civilized, this is a form of social progress. Do we have to have a situation in which the businessman is always villainous?
Of course not.
No. So therefore it's a legitimate protest. Incidentally, Archie, the program that I used to watch when it was on Saturday, is Archie Bunker.
Yes. Very good show.
Now, it's a hilarious. But Archie Bunker is the greatest anti-conservative ripoff in the history of modern offensives.
I agree with you.
I mean, you don't need Karl Marx. All you need is Archie Bunker.
Would make you
he's absolutely despicable, but he's kind of endearing in a way.
Well, this is the
don't you go giving yourself assets. All conservatives are not endearing.
No. I say the remarkable thing about it is that in a hideous kind of a way, there's something endearing about Archie's a horrible man.
There's something endearing about him, but his points of view are always held up to be absolutely preposterous, and not only that, mean.
He's a coward, a bully, cheat.
But this is stupid. Why'd she put up with him? Mrs. Bunker.
Well, Norman Lear wanted her to be stupid, you see. Perhaps the thesis is that you have to be stupid be married to Archie,
it's more interesting than that. She is the saintly liberal. She is the liberal foil for all of his cruelty. She is the humanitarian
liberal.
She's
the mediatrix, as we Catholics say.
Well, she is a person who can handle all of his evil because she is so humanitarian and good. But your point about Archie Bunker is well taken. You have to say to yourself, look at a generation that's grown up watching nothing but television. What must they think of people who are businessmen? What must they think of professional military officers? What must they think of bureaucrats? What must they think of clergymen after being exposed almost
of anybody who voted for Nixon? Would be another example.
Right.
And of course, it's marvelously paradoxical, since Carol O'Connor is himself, as you know, in private life, very liberal. I suppose, in a way, that gives him all the more pleasure in enacting the stereotype.
What a conservative would be, reactionary. Now, I don't. I know that you're a conservative, but I think you have some very liberal ideas. I don't know that you know you have them.
Well, don't ruin my reputation by ventilating it.
Touché.
As a matter of fact, I had an interesting experience. I really got the habit with Archie, and I didn't like to go out on Saturday night.
Yes.
But on one occasion, I had to go out to this party because my wife said there was simply no alternative. And who should be sitting next to me but Carol O'Connor? He had just come back from Rome with as he put it, the original anti-fascist from Hollywood. As a young Jewish activist, he had sold bundles for Britain and so on and so forth, and he just grew up with the complete anti-fascist business. And so he and Carol O'Connor had been two nights before at a nightclub in Rome, and they had heard this piano player. And so they asked the Italian guy, they said, who's playing? He said, well, a fellow called Mussolini. And he said, any relation? He said, yeah, son, Bruno Mussolini. But he's a great jazz fan, so he listened to him and had three or four or five drinks. At 4 o'clock in the morning, he leaned over and said, you know, that's a hell of a thing they did to your father.
That's marvelous.
So there's no question he has a genuine sense of humor, but would you think that Carol O'Connor would resist the conclusions that you drew in your book?
I don't think he would resist them. I think what he would say is he's just trying to entertain people. He has no political feeling about it, and if that's the way he turns out, then that's not his fault, that's the writer's fault, and the writers would say the same thing. We're just trying to entertain people and so forth.
Well, Ms. Fuldheim, do you think that there is
a... He's the avenging angel.
Well, that's right. Do you think that there is a shaping of an attitude? For instance, this presumptive suspicion of all oil people, might that have arisen from this situation?
No, I don't believe that. Years ago, at least 40 years ago when I was lecturing, I would get this question about the oil companies deliberately raising prices. I don't think there's a thing to do with it. But one must not forget that every periodical carries an article about that, practically every one. And I don't think the television has done it at all.
Well, but one must not forget also that in the polls that are taken about the standings of the respectability of various occupational groups, the groups that are demeaned by television consistently get lower and lower ratings. Now, I don't know whether there's cause and effect or not, but what I would like to suggest to you is that about 5 years ago, a big pharmaceutical company came out with an ad for a new deodorant called Sure. And they had a 6-week, very intensive flight of commercials. And at the end of 6 weeks, that product, which had just been introduced, was the largest selling deodorant in America. I would like to say, I don't see how it's possible that you can advertise a deodorant and get people to buy it and advertise for 30 years a point of view about businessmen, about military men, about small towns, about poor people, about rich people, about black people and white people, and not have that get bought too. It's simply beggars reality to say, the television time is worth $90,000 for 30 seconds for selling something, and also say that you don't sell anything on the shows.
Oh, come. People are smart enough to understand the difference between a commercial and an idea.
Well,
commercials, you have the Ford daughter making money. Bob Hope is making money on it. Everybody knows that it's purely a money-making scheme. People are not that stupid that they don't understand the difference.
Well, by your reasoning, the message of non-commercial should be all the stronger, because if people are prepared to resist commercials, they are not prepared to resist what comes between the commercials.
Just let him go. I don't agree with a single thing he says, excepting that it is true that all writers have types. There isn't a book that I pick up, unless most of the books I pick up, they go to bed in the first chapter. They used to wait till the second or third chapter. Now it's the first chapter. They all have. There are very few books in which every character is so well balanced that they have evil, they have good, they're liberal, they're reactionary. Most books are filled that way, and that's the way life is.
Exactly.
You look at a neighbor and you say, oh, I can't stand her. You know, she keeps her house dirty, or she's a gossip, or he isn't pleasant. We have a tendency to do that. But when it comes to a fundamental decision, I don't think people are fools, and I don't think Americans are fools, and I don't think that you can just feed them and the same thing comes out. Not at all.
Well, I think you have to wonder, though. First of all, of course, nobody here thinks the American people are fools, but I think you have to say, well, okay, here's a book and the author stereotypes it one way, and here's a book and the author stereotypes it another way. But what if every book, every magazine, and every newspaper stereotyped everyone the same way? That would be what you get on television, except it's much stronger because TV is far more pervasive. And it seems to me that even people who are not fools can eventually be persuaded by what they see on TV. I know that I constantly run into people who are bitterly disappointed at some facet of real life because it does not conform to what they had expected based on television. As I am always running into people who say, oh, why do I have to do such and such? Why do I have to work all day sitting behind a typewriter? Why do I have to work all day sitting in a law library? Starsky and Hutch don't do that. Or Suzanne Somers on Three's Company don't do that.
Come, how many people in this audience do you think are saying, why do I have to go back and wash the dishes while Dorothy Fuldheim sits there and talks with, what's your name?
I won't tell.
Okay, keep it a secret. I mean,
bailed you out once, but that's all. That's your ration.
I mean, I just don't think that people are that stupid. I mean, the people.
You mean
that
you think that people can watch life on television, see a life of absolutely effortless abundance, and compare their own lives to it, and not feel some sense of bitterness?
Let me tell you, my friend. I used to see Theda Bara. You know, she was the vampiest vamp. I mean, all she had to do was to lift one eyelid, and every man fell before her. Well, I never got the idea that I could do it.
But were you watching her 5 hours a day, every day of the week?
No, but when I did watch her for 2 hours, as long as the movie lasted, that impact was greater than the one that you watch on television every day. I don't think people are that susceptible. Now, if your president went on the air and made some thundering statement about what he was going to do about, help me out again, salt?
Salt, sure.
Well, you give that grudgingly. Have you got a better idea?
Salt, too.
That's right. Salt, too. People would listen, and even their prejudices, if they listen to somebody whose opinion. For example, you were a great example of that this noon. Great example. Because you riveted attention, and people are not going to forget it. Now, it is true that if he came on every day and he said the same thing, well, you just would lose your viewers. I mean,
you'd have to create more problems for me to solve.
Yeah, that's right.
You do grant that, don't you, Ms. Fuldheim, that the so-called the Tantalus complex, or even the revolution of rising expectations, is certainly accelerated by the existence of television.
Let me ask you.
Yeah.
Let me ask you, Mr. Buckley.
Yeah.
What is wrong about having rising expectations? Maybe that's the best thing that can happen to American people.
There's nothing wrong with stimulating an ethos, but it is very wrong to stimulate superstitions and the notion that one can have, for instance, color television or washing machines or whatever, without exertion. is something which is lethal.
People don't believe that. They know. It's like when I read fairy tales. Even at the ripe age of 7, I knew that there was no reality to that.
A, you're much brighter than most people, and B,
I will not contest that statement.
That's right.
That goes without any argument.
And B, fairy tales are presented as surrealistic, but there's nothing surrealistic about the automatic ice maker. You actually see it, and you somehow develop an appetite for it. $60 billion a year are spent in advertising on television for very good reasons, as Mr. Stein indicated. Now, does this or does this not foster certain attitudes? Many of them are acquisitive. Fine if it makes people work harder,
that's right.
But not quite fine if it is expected that all of this sort of waft in from Washington, D.C., or through some local welfare.
Well, just in an even more miraculous process than that, I think really you are a most extraordinarily realistic and tough-minded person, Ms. Fuldheim. If you can watch television day after day, hour after hour, without having it affect you at all.
Let me tell you, let me give you another example. In our studio, I don't know how many people there are working. They know the difference in salaries. They do not go around saying, we're going to tear off his jacket, the manager's jacket, or my dress, because they know we're getting more. People are more realistic, and they understand that there are differences. The difference between you and myself is not in arguing the lack of classic nobility in all of these shows that we show. It's just that I believe people are more sensible. I don't think they're as susceptible.
Well, I'm not certain how susceptible they are. I find it hard to believe that they would not be susceptible at all. What the book points out is not, the book does not attempt to measure how much the audience is affected by this. The book points out, and I point out to you, Ms. Fuldheim, that TV is highly stereotypical, homogeneous, and ideological. And that if you, and what the results of that will be, I'm not quite sure. I do think that it is worth noting that the most powerful medium in the history of the world is controlled by a very small, idiosyncratic, homogeneous group of people. I mean, I think if the...
You mean
if
the people who write the...
The people who write and produce
for
TV.
What's the difference between government? Was it so terrible when we had monarchies, was it?
Well, I think... Terrible in what?
When we had monarchies. I wish you'd pay
attention
to what I'm saying.
Well, you're asking the wrong person.
You know, it's important. I'm trying to win an argument, and I'm not.
We didn't have monarchies and TV at the same time.
No, but of course not. excepting when Mrs. Landry and... what was the other one...
Kennedy?
No, which was the other king of England? Edward. You know, we do have them, but we know it's make-believe.
Well, but we don't know that TV is make-believe because it's there 5 hours a day in front of most people watching. Suppose you had a situation in which for 6 hours a day you lived your life, then for 5 hours a day you went to the home of a very rich relative. Now, don't you think, I'm sure you wouldn't because you don't seem to be susceptible to this at all, but don't you imagine that some poor people...
Well, you're irritating me, so I am susceptible. Don't say that.
Don't you think that some poor people might say to themselves, gee, I like spending these 5 hours with this rich person much better than I do being at home, and don't you think that might eventually affect that person's expectations?
Mr. Stein, I want all my friends and all my relatives to be rich so I don't have to worry about them. See, if they're rich, you know they can take care of any problem that comes up. I'm all for it.
But in order to become rich, they're going to have to work during some of the time that they would otherwise spend watching television.
They do. They do. Take any woman here and ask her what she does with her day. Who do you suppose washes the windows? Who do you suppose makes out the laundry list? They have to take some time off. Even my maid has time off, and I know what hour she's taking off. This is sheer rubbish. The American people are not indolent.
It's not rubbish that the per capita increase in productivity is reducing in the last few years.
And let me ask you why. Mm-hmm. One of the reasons is that our mechanical equipment is not what it used to be.
Let me ask you why that is.
I don't know why.
I do.
I don't know why.
Well, one of the reasons is a lack of pride in job. Another reason is unrealistic amortization rates. Another thing is super high taxation.
Environmental regulation.
That has nothing to do with the worker. If you reduce taxes, the government, as you well know, would take in so much more and would give everyone else a larger purchasing power. This is one of our weaknesses, the enormous tax, and I think Mrs. Thatcher understands that. But the key
to American wealth is the capitalization per job.
Of course.
Now, if that doesn't increase,
that's not the worker's job. That's not. It's the government's. I hold the government completely.
Most investment is private.
Of course, mm-hmm. but the government has allowed unions. The government has allowed the day to be limited to a certain number of hours. The government takes enormous amounts away from any profitable business, uh-huh. enormous ones. And I think that is...
It penalizes...
That's right. It penalizes success.
Success, yeah.
Doesn't make any sense to me. But I don't know what that has to do with this. Productivity is not simply the guy who goes in and works for 5 or 6 hours. Productivity comes up from the top when you take away so much money that a company cannot introduce new machinery. Mm-hmm. Of course it's going to lessen it. That's where the weakness is. I don't think it's watching television.
Well, with all due respect, there have been studies made on a more empirical and scientific basis than yours, Ms. Fuldheim.
Why is it mine scientific?
Yours is
just because I don't have the same number of people. What do you suppose I read? What do you suppose I investigate? I do editorials. I'm very familiar with some of these figures, but the fact that they are there does not authenticate them, particularly in my mind, because I still believe that people have more common sense.
Well, with all due respect, there have been studies shown that show that people's enthusiasm in the workplace is diminishing at a steady and rapid rate.
That's right. I don't deny that. But there are reasons for it, and it's not because of television. That's my point.
No, the reason, why do you exclude television? We know that 70% of the American people get their news primarily from the television, and I suspect that they get their attitudes primarily from television. It's inconceivable. Everybody agrees, for instance, that nobody who is not telegenic can possibly become president of the United States. Everybody agrees. Abraham Lincoln might not have made it through New Hampshire because he might not have done well
Winston
on television.
Winston Churchill wasn't pretty.
But he wasn't running on television, Ms. Fuldheim. Yeah.
Oh, well, okay,
But I don't see why you are so hostile to an inquiry as to the effect of television on evolutionizing attitudes. One of them is a certain sluggishness at work. A lot of work is very boring. The assembly line is extremely boring. In Sweden, they have to get people from Turkey to run the assembly lines. Professor Galbraith, if he's correct, says only black people will consent to work in the assembly lines in Detroit a generation now. There is a kind of a shrinkage
from the
toughness of work. Well, it may be, though, that is a softening influence, something that encourages a kind of indulgence. Without which we cannot continue to make the kind
Mr.
of progress
Buckley,
we have.
You're altogether too wise not to understand what it is that has decreased productivity. And it is certainly this country that was at the peak. They had, Patent Office celebrated its 100th birthday or something. And I remember the awesome number of patents that had been issued.
Diminishing now, by the way.
Of course. Mm-hmm. Now, is that due? Is that due to lack of money? Or is that due to the refusal to accept? I don't know what it is, but I know that that's why you have a lack of productivity. You could increase it, certainly.
Well, do you think that the American worker works as hard now, say, as he did in 1959?
Well, I don't know. I do, so I don't know what... I can't remember.
Interestingly enough, the American student does.
The American student.
Yes, it's tougher to get a degree.
I think they work longer hours.
But do you think that the American worker, not counting students, because calling students workers is a kind of whimsical idea?
Well, it may be whimsical, but it's not unrelated. That is to say, they're highly motivated, in part because of the competitiveness. If you want to become a doctor at age 16, age 17, you practically have to abandon social life. Mm. But I think it is true that what happened in England about 10 or 15 years ago seems to be happening here.
That's right.
All of the red tape, the bureaucracy,
right.
The American appetite for ingenious solutions. I'll give you an example. This happens to be very vivid in my memory because I wrote a piece about it. Why do American people stand in line for gasoline when they wouldn't have to stand in line if the gasoline would give them a coupon, which would say, yeah, that's right, exactly. Which would say, okay, you're 21. We're now working on order number one. and it's approximately 5 minutes per number, why don't people do that? Now, it seems to me that in America, that as nervous, with a highly developed nervous system of 10, 15, 20 years ago, wouldn't have stood waiting 2 hours, 3 hours in line, chugging forth a few inches every few minutes. Isn't that inconsistent with American ingenuity?
I think so, yes.
Actually, someone in L.A. was doing that, and he was told it was illegal to do it.
That compounds the felony, doesn't
yes.
it?
You know, I read the other day that the government has a book of 60,000 pages, which includes 9,000 regulations, which demands a return of over 500 million answers. Well, I think that's one of the reasons we don't have productivity. Well,
but I'm sure that is a major reason, but I just would like to suggest to you that there is a whole world out there, a kind of dream world, which you can get simply by turning on the television, and the people who watch that dream world then have a very hard time coming down to earth. And I will offer you this example, which I think you might not find as far-fetched as you seem to find the rest of what I say, which is have you ever been with a person who has had a flat tire recently and had that person say, oh boy, I wish I could change the channel? And that, it seems to me, is what, in a nutshell, is happening to the American people, that when they see something disagreeable or difficult happening, they have the idea that they can just change the channel and be out of it and onto another show. And they can't, and I think it's very upsetting.
What is your point, Mr. Stein, that a guy whose tire is gone wishes he could have some way that he could change it or someone could come and do it? I don't see how that's related. The fact that he uses the word channel, it's just part of
well,
our vocabulary.
The relation, Ms. Fuldheim, is that people have the idea that there is an alternate reality which is incredibly, perfectly effortless, which they can get by simply switching a channel, and that real life is far more painful and unpleasant than that.
With that, we will introduce our examiner. Mr. Thomas Vail is a graduate of Princeton who went to fight in the war in the Navy, after which he came to the Cleveland News, where he worked briefly before going to the Cleveland News Leader, which he now serves as publisher and editor, indeed has for the last 16 years. Mr. Vail.
Yes, I would like to, perhaps starting with Mr. Stein, ask, you've been all having a great time debating the power of these stereotypes and so forth. I'd like to ask Mr. Stein, first of all, why these stereotypes exist, in his opinion, and secondly, I'd like to ask the panel as a whole, what can be done about it?
Well, I think the stereotypes exist exclusively because those are the stereotypes in the minds of the producers and writers of TV shows. A producer of a TV show, as you probably know, is not like the producer of a movie. The producer of a TV show actually writes a great deal of the TV show. And what I found in doing the research for my book was that the same stereotypes that you see on the television tube are the same stereotypes that are in the minds of the people who write for television.
Now, but who are these people?
A couple of hundred very influential, very well-wired TV writers in Hollywood. There's a very small pool of veteran qualified TV writers, and they all know each other, they all share the same values, they're all friends with each other and reinforce each other's values. The question that comes to mind is why these people, who are extremely well-heeled people by almost any standard, that is a successful TV producer makes about $50,000 a week, should be...
A week?
A week. Why they should be so hostile to businessmen and to wealthy people in general. And I think it has something to do with the fact that almost none of them grew up wealthy, and they have a kind of vestigial hostility towards what they see as power centers of the world. I mean, I think they would see the world that they imagine Mr. Buckley comes from as the real power center, and they hate it.
Don't you think that some of these things that we're debating now actually relate to the traditional role of the media to often go after whoever is up there, whoever has made it in the world becomes a target?
I think there's something to that, but I think that you cannot realistically say, for instance, that military men in this society have made it, or that small towns in this society have made it, and therefore your explanation would not really explain their hostility towards, say, small towns or military.
Well, what would be your explanation for that?
Well, I think that they are mostly people from big cities who have had bad experiences in small towns. They're often people who were drafted into the Army and had very bad experiences in the Army. and have a kind of lingering hostility towards those institutions. In addition, there is undoubtedly some ideological basis for it, that they have a kind of feeling that there are certain prescribed oppressors of the society. And one of them is rural reaction.
Let's talk a little bit about what can be done about this. It's nice to say all these things, that television is pervasive and people watch it all the time. People have debated for years, all right, what can be done about this? And then there's all this stuff about freedom of the press, and we can't have government saying how much she'll be on and of one kind of show or another. So my question to the panel is, and maybe start with Mr. Buckley, as to what can we do about this situation?
I don't think...
If anything one, should be done about it.
I don't think
it.
One can do anything about it except focus attention on it. What gave Agnew his notoriety was that he said something the truth of which was almost instantly recognized. I was talking, it happened I was in Honolulu at the time he made the speech. I was talking with the owner of a local radio station, and he said that the number of people who poured in their complaints over his handling of his programming astonished him. He said he had absolutely no idea until he went back and surveyed his own programming, that in fact it had been tendentious. Look at CBS. CBS all of a sudden decided to put Spectrum.
The media.
Look at 60 Minutes. They started the Shana Alexander, Jack Kilpatrick thing as a result of that. I think the purpose of such a book as Mr. Stein is to draw attention to something which we hadn't actually been crystallized for us. Isn't that the beginning?
Well, maybe so. Ms. Fuldheim, do you have a comment on that?
But you know, for some reason, sir, for some whimsical reason, as I listen to this, I'm reminded of an assignment given by a teacher to her fourth grade students to come back with a story of their origin. So this youngster came home and he said, Mom, where did I come from? Well, she thought about the birds and the bees and she said, well, the stork brought you. He said, well, where did Grandma come from? She was quandering. She said, well, the stork brought Grandma, too. He said, well, where did I come from? She said, of course the stork brought you. Kid came back the next day with an essay which read, for three generations, there's not been a normal birth in our family. And I can't help thinking that, I mean, maybe, Mr. Stein, we ought to change the people who are doing the writing.
I think that's exactly what I was going to say, Ms. Fuldheim. That I
change
think,
the writers
I think,
who have less stereotypes.
I'll give you an example.
But you've got to get entertaining writers.
You have to get entertaining and smart writers, but Hollywood does not really draw the brightest people. I have a very good friend, this is sad but true, a very good friend, who was just graduating from Radcliffe College, and she was offered a job writing for a Tandem T18, Norman Lear's company, or working for the ABC News staff. Well, she being a bright person from a good family and having gone to an Eastern prestige college, of course, unhesitatingly chose the news side. And this is the tragedy of television, that the writers for TV are not really the best possible writers there could be.
Excuse me, but Mr. Vail, wouldn't you guess that whoever creates something like All in the Family has got to be terribly bright?
Well, Norman Lear is terribly bright, but I mean, Norman, but he's very, very unusual.
But does he write All in the Family?
No, but he has a few very good writers writing All in the Family, but bear in mind that there are about
20... Did they not go to Radcliffe?
No, but there are about 20 good writers. There are about 20 sitcoms on now, and really only two or three of them are written halfway decently, and that gives you some idea of how many good writers there are.
On that line, I'd like to shift just a little bit to, we're talking about all the time about sitcoms and things like that of the entertainment side, but as a panel, all of you have had contact with very interesting people in the media business, and I would like to ask whether you believe with people that you've seen and interviewed, particularly Mr. Buckley and Ms. Fuldheim, whether there is a direct relationship in the way that person handles television and their performance in real life.
I think they're absolutely normal. I certainly am. I don't think that you can, unless you're an actor, unless you are presenting some role, certainly the people that I've interviewed have been absolutely honest, but their honesty and their ability to project it is a talent that they have, but it also depends upon the interrogator. I mean, if you don't ask the right significant questions, you're going to get, you know. But I'm very bothered about this, Mr. Stein says. It's as though we were condemning not only the writers, but the whole population. And the people that I've met are not stupid. You know, Mr. Vail, when I say something in a commentary and there's an inaccuracy, I get a lot of letters telling me that I don't know what I'm talking about.
Yes.
Somebody's checking on that.
There's always a balance wheel. I agree with you there.
Why do we have to import so much of the good stuff from Great Britain,
well,
Mr. Vail?
That's right. Particularly the public television has got a huge amount of it. But what I was trying to get at was not just on the entertainment side, but you've interviewed a lot of political figures, for example. Do you find that some of these people are so adept at handling the media that they are putting something over on people and that actually their real performance doesn't measure up to that performance?
I think that is right. Every single presidential candidate, including the president that is now in office, have said one thing to me during my interrogation. It has not come to pass. Now, it may be that they are confronted with difficulties that they can't overcome. They may have a majority in the Senate, a majority in the Congress. But I easily detect a phony, and they rarely appear, because you can't hide that. You can ask questions, and I think you'll agree with me.
But
that will
Buckley,
reveal.
Does Mr. Buckley agree with that view? I'm not talking about whether they put something over on you, but do they put something over on the people that are receiving their TV?
I was talking about the audience.
Well, I think there is a metaphysics of Democratic campaigning that requires people to say things, and say things in such a way as pleases the people who are listening to him, even if the people know that what is being said to them is unrealistic.
Yes.
If Teddy Kennedy were here right now, he would say, do you really believe that the poor people in America ought to freeze to death so that Mobile can increase its dividends? Now, it would take actually about 10 minutes of analysis to set that straight
yeah.
for you people to understand it.
Yeah.
But people get a certain sense of gratification
that.
From hearing it.
Right.
Even economists.
Yeah.
Oh. I think that's true.
Would you say that Truman would answer that way? This is an honest guy.
What about Mr. Truman?
Well, anybody who studies the rhetoric of Mr. Truman when he ran 1948 would not find that he set any standards to which we should repair. He called Eisenhower the leader of the fascist movement in the United States.
Well, supposing he believed that, wasn't that legitimate?
No, he didn't believe for a
minute. How do you know he didn't?
Because he was too bright. As a matter of fact, I was telling Mr. Vail coming up here that he once told Herbert Hoover, about whom he had said it, a great big rally in Boston, he said that the Republican Party wants to grind a heel on the poor, following the tradition in which they were instructed by Herbert Hoover. This is after Herbert Hoover had just finished bailing out his whole civil service.
And Mr. Buckley, he accosted
Mr. Truman with this a few months later. And Truman said, he said, that was the most terrible speech. When I came to that paragraph, I almost didn't read it.
I don't know if that was true or not.
Let me ask a question here about all of you have encountered very interesting people. I'd like to go and ask Mr. Buckley to start with, and Ms. Fuldheim and Mr. Stein, who is the most interesting person you have ever interviewed?
Well,
barring present company.
I feel that way. Nicholson's first name? Harold.
Harold Nicholson.
Yeah, he said 99 out of 100 people are interesting, and the 100th is interesting because he's an exception. So I really tend to find almost everybody interesting in different ways.
Right.
I think the one that influenced me the most, that had a profound effect on me, was Helen Keller, because I perceived someone who had a limited number of senses. And I suddenly thought, what an extraordinary gift. Nature could have developed all of us that way. but I have all these senses so that the universe, even the ability to conceive of an expanding universe, it left a tremendous impression on me.
Very interesting. Mr. Stein, how about
the most interesting? Can I give two for a different reason?
Sure.
One is
you can do anything for 2 minutes.
The most fascinating in terms of the most richly worked personality, a person who's just endless layers of fascination, was Richard Nixon. And the person who is the kind of most inspiring in the sense that after talking to him you get a feeling of euphoria is Norman Lear.
Very interesting. I'd like to ask the panel, as we only have a few minutes left, going with Mr. Buckley first, what do you think the greatest concern of people is today?
With television?
Not on television. I mean, in general. I mean, I guess I'd put the question like this. Most people really are better off than they have ever been before. They are also complaining more. Now, this raises a few questions as to why, and it also, I think, would be very interesting for this audience to know how you feel in talking to so many different people, what you think the greatest concern of most people is right now.
Well, I don't think most people are better off. I don't think they're any better off than they were in 1970 in terms of the purchasing power of the dollar, in terms of the problems that they face, educating their children, or curbing crime, trying to lead civil lives. I think that the sense of continuing guaranteed American prosperity is dissipating.
I happen to agree with Mr. Buckley about that, but because there is an anxiety about everything, there seems to be a disorder, not only the universe, because it's an expanding universe, everything has been, all certitude has been taken away from them. But I think specifically what really worries them is inflation.
Right. I think it's the same thing. I think people feel that the society is collapsing. I think that there's a kind of vague feeling that these are the last days of the American empire and that the whole thing is just coming apart.
Do you all believe that America's had its day and is on its way down?
On that cheerful note, I want to thank Mrs. Fuldheim and Mr. Stein.
Thank you.
And Mr. Vail, ladies and gentlemen.
Bound transcript of this program, send $1 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. Indicate the subject of the program and please allow 3 weeks for delivery. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content. Funding was provided by this station and by other public television stations. Thank you.